Thank you for joining us for the first installment of the Body in the East Asian Imaginaire series. My name is Or Porat, and I'm a postdoctoral researcher and instructor in the Department of East Asian Languages and Civilizations at the University of Chicago. I'm thrilled to bring this series to you as we welcome tonight's guest speaker, Dr. Jeffrey Kotyk with the University of British Columbia, who will discuss today or tonight, depends where you are, the body and the stars, astral-physiological thinking in medieval China. This series of lectures taking place Monday evenings during the month of May will investigate the role of the body in the East Asian imaginaire and how it has been configured in religious, historical, and cultural context from the medieval period to the modern era. For additional information and to register for the other upcoming talks that are part of the series, please click on the link that will be made available in the chat box. This series and tonight's event is sponsored by the Center for East Asian Studies at the University of Chicago, otherwise known as CEAS. CEAS is an interdisciplinary nexus, clearinghouse, and resource for academic exploration and support related to the study of China, Japan, and Korea. For more information on CEAS and to subscribe to receive weekly outreach emails pertaining to future events sponsored by the center, please click on the links that will be provided in the chat box. Now, before I introduce our guest speaker, I would like to remind everyone about tonight's Q&A session that will follow tonight's presentation. To ask a question, please be sure to type in your questions into the Q&A box. So tonight's speaker, Jeffrey Kotyk, received his doctoral degree from Leiden University in 2017. Dr. Kotyk is presently the Sheng Yan Education Foundation Postdoctoral Fellow in Chinese Buddhism at the University of British Columbia in Vancouver, Canada. He is primarily interested in the transcultural history between China and neighboring cultures in the medieval period. He has published in journals such as Tongpao and Asia Major. And I would add here that Dr. Kotyk published over 25 peer-reviewed articles already. So in many more journals than the two that I've just mentioned. So Dr. Kotyk, the stage is all yours. Welcome.
Thank you very, very much for having me, Ori. And I'd also very much like to thank the University of Chicago for hosting this great talk, and for facilitating this great opportunity for dialogue. So tonight I will be discussing the body and the stars, that's astral-physiological thinking in medieval China. So normally when we're discussing the body in East Asia, especially in the Buddhist context, we normally don't think of astrology and the stars, constellations and zodiac signs. Whereas if we look to the Persian, the Arabic and the European, as well as the Indian worlds, there actually was often associations between the body, health, well-being, longevity, and the stars and the movements of the planets. One of the premises of astrology is that so above, so below. And this is something that we don't really see in discussions of the body in East Asia. But today I want to give a general survey of the material and also some of the iconography that connects the human body with the stars. So to begin with, I'll start with this quote, which comes from a 10th century astrology text, probably from the early Song Dynasty. "All disasters and fortunes are predetermined in human life. There is no fleeing from fate anywhere in heaven and earth." So what that means is that you are bound to a fate, and that fate is also determined by your birth chart. And we'll discuss this. What is a birth chart? Well, you might have heard of a horoscope before. Most people think of a horoscope nowadays as their sun sign. They might say, well, I'm a Aries, I'm a Taurus, etc. But originally horoscopy emerged in Alexandria in Egypt, starting around the second century BCE. And as David Pingree points out, it was an amalgamation, a union of aspects of advanced Babylonian celestial divination with Aristotelian physics and Hellenistic astronomy. I mean, that's a lot to digest in just one sentence, but what that means is that there was this intercultural mingling of Egyptian, Greek, Mesopotamian, and also Syrian culture. And that gave birth to the practice of astrology, horoscopy. And in order to cast a horoscope, that is a birth chart, you have to be able to calculate the positions of the planets and the zodiac signs at a given moment, particularly for when a person is born. And then on the basis of their birth chart, you can analyze their fate and fortune. And there's two kinds of horoscopy, generally speaking. There's natal astrology, and that's predicting the fate of an individual in their life. And there's also electional astrology, and that attempts to determine opportune times to carry out certain activities. Now, for the present discussion, natal astrology is really key because on the basis of a horoscope, and what we're seeing here is a horoscope from 13th century Japan, you can predict a person's future illnesses. Astrological medicine is something that's recognized, especially in the history of astrology in Europe and also in the Arabic world, and also Ayurveda and Jyotish, that's in India. And normally we don't discuss astrological medicine in East Asia, but as I will point out today, there actually was attempts by astrologers to predict the illness of a person based on their birth chart like this. But then we have to ask too, do Buddhists believe in astrology? And this is something that I've argued in some of my papers, that Buddhists in fact did believe in astrology. And in fact, if we do a survey of the Vinaya, that is the monastic codes of ancient India, we actually see a lot of passive knowledge of astrology. And there's actually very few examples in Buddhist literature of direct opposition or refutation of astrology. And there's just this one text, the Saddharma Smriti Upasthana Sutra, which actually challenges some of the premises of astrology. But in general, what we do see is that Buddhists in India believed in astrology. And there was actually over the centuries a sort of development of something called Buddhist astrology. And they incorporated astrological elements as the tradition of Indian astrology also developed over time. Now, I also would like to point out that the nakshatras, the lunar mansions, are also indigenous to India. So before the introduction of Hellenistic, Greco-Egyptian astrology into India, into South Asia, there was the indigenous form of astrology, which was based primarily on the position of the moon relative to 28 or 27 lunar stations. And so this tradition also was integrated into some Buddhist literature, and then that also came to China over the centuries. So there were two main transmission routes we will recall, one going through what's now Southeast Asia and one going over the Tauran Basin into China. And this was the conduit through which some early astrological knowledge came from India into China. And one of the first texts that actually describes Indian astrology in Chinese is the Shardula Karna Avadana. So the first version of this text was translated sometime in 307 to 313. And then there was another translation done in the 5th century, most likely by Gunabhadra. Now, if we just look at these two example sentences from the Matanga Sutra, which is the second translation of the Shardula Karna Avadana, it says, "Those born when the moon transits Purva Palguni will have a short lifespan. Those born when the moon transits Ashlesha will have many desires." So what that means is that you would determine which of the lunar mansions or lunar stations the moon was in when a person was born, and then on the basis of that predict something such as a short lifespan, or that they would have many desires. So at this point, we're starting to see a certain amount of astrological thinking relative to the lunar mansions. And the Chinese astronomy also had a system of lunar mansions, an indigenous system of lunar mansions. That's so they divide up the orbital path of the moon into 28 stations as well. But the Chinese system is very different from the Indian system. But the Chinese generally saw the two as functional equivalents for one another. But this became a novel idea that an individual's fate could be tied to the position of the moon. and you could predict a person's lifespan, their desires. Also, there's in some of this literature too, in this period, it also will say that born under this lunar station, this person will suffer from a skin disease, or this person will have this condition. So this sort of connection between the stars and the body and health is starting to be introduced through the Buddhist literature at this time. And then also through Buddhist literature, we see the first examples of the zodiac signs, sort of embodiment of the cosmos in anthropomorphic and zoomorphic forms. And so at first in the Chandragarbha Parivarta in the 6th century, we see the zodiac signs transliterated from Sanskrit into Chinese characters. Now at this point, they don't really have much of a functional utility in the Buddhist literature because they more just have a sort of symbolic position in the literature. But what's interesting is that the lunar mansions, as well as the zodiac signs, were understood as divinities in the Indian context, and that was also transmitted over to China. So you have this sort of astral pantheon, celestial pantheon, that is transmitted from India to China. And so the Chinese would look at this literature and they would see the lunar mansions, and they're the gods of the lunar mansions. And then there's also the gods of the zodiac signs. So there's this sort of sense that there's a sentience in the sky. And then this is also a sort of architect of fate. Now, what's also interesting too is that the lunar mansions in the traditional Indian system are associated with Vedic deities. So one of the lunar mansions, Kotyk, for example, is associated with Agni, the fire god. And this sort of astrological lore is also being transmitted into China through Buddhist literature at this time. Now, the real need to observe astrology in the Chinese Buddhist context starts with the advent of Mantrayana, or esoteric Buddhism, from the 720s. And this new system required the observance of astrology in wartime rituals. So this is different from natal astrology. This is electional astrology. So you have to determine the best time in order to carry out a ritual. So there's this one line from the Chinese translation of the Mahavairochana Sutra. On the morning of a propitious day, having determined the day on which the time, lunar mansion, and planets are all in harmony, and at a time before the morning meal with an auspicious sign, carry out the ritual, build the mandala. But as we will recall, in this system of esoteric Buddhism, the point is to bring the body, speech, and mind, the three mysteries, in line with Mahavairochana, Vairochana Buddha. So what it is suggesting here, the underlying premise here, is that there are these certain tides of time that you have to observe in order to maximize the efficacy of your ritual. So in order to attain rapid enlightenment, as a condition for that, you actually have to observe astrological conventions. So your own transformation from a unenlightened being into a Buddha actually requires, in this system, a certain amount of observance of astrology. So the fate of a Buddhist practitioner is also tied to the stars. And the Mahavairochana and the associated mandala, the Garbhadhatu mandala, also introduced various iconography, and this really bolstered the astral pantheon in China. And so what we're looking at here is the zodiac signs in the Taizo Zuzo, which is a document of the mandala icons that was brought from China to Japan by the Japanese Tendai monk Enchin sometime in the mid 9th century. But this document is a copy of a Chinese original, which is said to go back to Shubhakara Simha in the 720s when the Mahavairochana Sutra was translated. And so here we can see anthropomorphic and zoomorphic representations of the stars. And so at this point, you actually have iconographical representations of the asterisms involved in astrology. And this is also when we start seeing sentient deities in China associated with the planets. So we'll recall that in China, in ancient times, the planets were associated particularly with the five elements. So Muxing, the wood star, is Jupiter, and Jinxing is Venus, the metal star. And the moon is Tai Yin, so great Yin, as in Yin and Yang. But here we see the Indian deities, the Vedic deities, in sort of anthropomorphic form. So again, there's a sort of imprint onto the religious culture at the time that the planets are not just insentient material forces that somehow affect your fate, but these are actual sentient deities, and that you can somehow negotiate with them, that your fate, your health, your well-being, your bodily form, your expression of your form is somehow tied to these astral deities. And so the Mahavairochana Sutra's commentary by Shubhakara Simha and Ishing even suggests that it is skillful means, it is upaya in order to have a sort of good relationship with these deities. The Navagraha, the nine planets, which includes the seven visible planets and Rahu and Ketu. So Rahu refers to ascending node of the moon, and Ketu in this context refers to comets. But the point here is that it's skillful means in order to have a good relationship with the astral deities. And that's one thing I want to emphasize here, is that in this context, the astral deities are not just material forces, they're actual gods and goddesses. And also the lunar mansions. So before the 28 lunar mansions of ancient China, they didn't have this anthropomorphic representation. And then with the introduction of esoteric Buddhism, they did. And so they were also conceived of as deified sentient beings. But the responsibility to produce an authoritative manual on astrology fell to Amoghavadra in 759. And then 764, he produced the Shouyao Jing, the scripture of asterisms and planets. And this was in response to a Chinese need for an astrological manual to time rituals. But this text did a lot more than that, because it started actually looking at the fates of individuals. Now, in the ancient form of astrology in China, it's called field allocation astrology. That's chiefly concerned with the fate of the state, and to a lesser extent with the reigning monarch. Whereas Indian astrology, particularly in this text, is concerned not just with the timing of rituals, but also with the fate of an individual. And so it starts explaining some of these more advanced techniques for evaluating a person's well-being and fate in life. So there's this system of the nine stars. And what it does is it divides 27 lunar mansions into individual segments. And each of these segments has a theme. And so we can see here that some of them deal with life, prosperity, decay, danger. And so this affects not just a person's, you know, financial or social fate, but also their bodily health. And so you have to keep track of the transits of the planets. And the text says that when a planet infringes upon the lunar mansions of fate or the womb, it will be a time of distress for this person. And so they should cultivate merit, recite mantras, do recitations, and build an altar to dispel these calamities. So because the planets in particular were conceived of as deities, that also means as a religious practitioner, you can actually carry out pujas or rituals in order to alleviate the ill effects that have been predicted on the basis of your birth chart, based on the time of your birth. And so you can actually start using, means such as mantras and pujas and ritual offerings and so on to start to navigate fate, to negotiate fate, and also to preemptively eliminate calamities before they arise. Also, at this point too, the zodiac signs associated with the person are also observed. So it says here concerning Cancer, that the moon is positioned here, the deity is like a crab, and hence the name Zodiac Palace of the Crab. Somebody born under this sign will be wicked in nature, deceitful, intelligent, and short-lived. So again, here we see a prediction about a person's long-term longevity based on their zodiac sign. And this also applies too to the 7 days of the week. So the 7 days of the week, Sunday, Monday, etc., that is a concept that originates also in Greco-Egyptian Alexandria, starting around the second century BCE, and then it spread into the Latin Roman Empire. And the 7 day week progressively also entered the Persian, Indian worlds. And then around this time also, it was transmitted to China. But the 7 day week wasn't used in the civil calendar. The original Chinese calendar functioned sufficiently well. And the 7 day week instead was used as a sort of religious calendar, because Sunday was considered the most auspicious day to carry out rituals. But also the day of the week that a person was born also determined to some extent their well-being. So those born on Sunday are strategic, dignified, beautiful in appearance, filial, and short-lived. Whereas somebody born on Saturday under Saturn will be predicted to be long-lived. So again, there's all these multiple astrological factors that are now being associated with the well-being and even appearance of a person over time. And then more advanced forms of astrology, particularly horoscopy, the casting of birth charts. So sometime after 764, Iranian horoscopy was introduced, most likely through Sogdians. And that's because we can infer that based on the fact that there's Sogdian loanwords in some of the relevant literature. And then there's this one text that was preserved in Japan, and it was carried over by Buddhist monks. I translate the title as The Secrets of the Seven Planet Apotropaism. I know that's a mouthful. But basically, it's a horoscopy manual, but it also provides mantras and various simple magical spells that one might do to mitigate the effects of predicted disasters on the basis of your horoscope. And so interest in horoscopy was most likely motivated initially by Buddhist astrology. And then this led to a more popular appreciation for astrology, not just in religious circles. We know that the Taoists also took an interest in horoscopy, but also in the wider civil society, because we see poets in the 9th century, such as Du Mu and also Han Yu, also discussing astrology in some of their work as well. So it entered the popular culture as well. And then people were concerned also with the movement of the planets over the course of time and the purported effects on their health. So this text has this one diagram of a horoscope chart. And if you can decipher this, which I have done, you can see that there's all these various factors that you can take into consideration now concerning a person's fate based on their birth chart, but also in the movements, also via the movements of the planets over the time, which is called the transits. And so one doctrine, which is quite essential to horoscopy, is the 12 places. So what you do is you divide the chart into 12 segments, starting at the ascendant, which is on the left side, and that represents the eastern horizon. And then you divide the sky into 12 segments like this. And each one of these segments represents a certain aspect of a person's life. So some of this concerns things like travel and the estate, siblings, but I would point out that the first and the eighth are really key to the present discussion. So what you would want to do is, if this was a person's birth chart, is you would look at which planets occupied the first and the eighth. So if there was a planet there, then you would want to evaluate its impact. So each of the planets, for example, has a positive or a negative effect, the malefics and the benefics. So for example, if you had Jupiter in the first house, that would probably be considered favorable because Jupiter is a benefic. Whereas if you had Mars, that might be considered detrimental. And similarly too, the eighth house, which here is called illness, is also associated with death. And so you would want to evaluate the planets or the condition of that house. And you could evaluate how this person is likely to die, how long they're likely to live. And so this doctrine contributed again to further discussions about the effect of the stars and the planets on a person's well-being over time. Now the text also introduces this concept of the nakshatra purusha, the literally lunar mansion person. And so on the left, we have the various parts of the body. And then on the right, we have the lunar mansions. And translated, it looks like this. And so this is a concept that's also attested in Jyotish, that is to say Indian astrology. Vihira Mihira's text, for example, similarly describes the nakshatra purusha. So in this case, we actually have a direct connection between various constellations in the Indian system and parts of the body. And it's on the basis of this too that you could start to evaluate a person's bodily health based on these associations and the transits of the planets through the different lunar mansions. Now, there was also a similar system, which isn't directly attested in East Asia at this time, called the zodiac man. And so on the left here, we're looking at a Persian manuscript from the medieval period. And on the right side, we're looking at a German European manuscript. So the human body is divided into different segments, and each of these segments is ruled over by one of the zodiac signs. And so in this system, for example, Scorpio, for example, rules over the loins. So that is, and Scorpio is ruled by Mars. So that part of the body is said to be ruled over, presided over by Mars. And so on the basis of this, you make various predictions about a person's health and well-being. Now, although this system isn't directly attested in East Asia, there's this very interesting icon in the Genzu Mandala, which is the mandala from China that was carried over to Japan. And here what we're looking at in the middle is Libra, and it's an old man. And the reason it's an old man is because that's actually Saturn, because Saturn has his exaltation in Libra. And then we have a similar looking icon in the Kitab al-Bulhan from the 14th century. And so this Arabic manuscript is most likely based on a much earlier Persian precedent. And then on the right side in the Persian zodiac man, we see that Libra presides over the abdomen area. And I think this is why Saturn in both these icons as Libra is grasping onto his abdomen. So this idea of this association between different body parts and zodiac signs is actually attested indirectly in the iconography of East Asia at this time, particularly in the Buddhist materials. And what's interesting is that in the relevant literature, we have the names of the planets in Chinese transliterated from Sogdian. And the Sogdian names are transcriptions of Middle Persian. And so the sort of system that we would be familiar with in the English-speaking world, such as naming the planets after the Roman gods, was also adopted in the Greek world. So they named the planets after their pantheon. And that tradition actually goes back to Mesopotamia. So for example, Mercury was Nabu, Jupiter was Marduk. And then the Persians also adopted this system. And then the Sogdians, on the basis of that, named the planets after the Persian gods. And then these names were transmitted over into Chinese. And what's interesting is that, so the planets in the astrological literature in East Asia also govern over certain parts of a person's lifespan. So for example, Saturn governs old age. And in the iconography, and also in some of the associated rituals, you have the themes of old age associated with Saturn. So here we see a later specimen from the East Asian art record. This is the iconographic drawing of Saturn at the New York City Met Museum from the 12th century in Japan, but this is a copy of a Song Dynasty icon. And so the relevant literature associates Saturn with old age. And so also in the associated traditions of astromagic as well, he's also associated with old age. So if you have to carry out a ritual either involving elderly people or involving your longevity, then you direct that toward Saturn. And so you see these themes originating from the Near East and being transmitted through Iranian intermediaries into China. And then eventually this gets all the way to Korea and Japan. Now, interestingly, also this association and this icon of Kronos, or of Saturn rather, goes back to Greco-Egyptian Kronos, which we can kind of see here as I've laid out. So on the left here, you have Kronos as the reaper of the wheat. And so he's hunched over and he's reaping the wheat. And then in the top right, we see the icon of Libra and we see the icon of Saturn in the East Asian mandala of the Garbhadhatu mandala. And so given the fact that he's holding a similar implement, in this case, he's holding a staff in East Asia, but originally he was holding a sickle, but he's hunched over and he wears the kind of skirt and then his head cap or his tuft of hair is very similar. So this icon is very similar also in the Middle Eastern manuscripts as well. So we can sort of draw this iconographical trail all the way from medieval East Asia back to Iran, and then even earlier to the Greco-Egyptian tradition. So this is very interesting. So in this way, there's this sort of conduit of astrological lore associated with the body and fate emanating from the Near East all the way to East Asia. And it was astrology that carried this over. And of course, there's also the prediction of illness on the basis of the movements of the planets in a birth chart. So for here, for example, here it says that Saturn transits the second place. There will be loss of wealth, disease most painful, and slander without truth to it. And it's not just Saturn, it's also Jupiter, for example. So when Jupiter transits the 10th place, there will be increase of illness, disputes, and injustice. The elderly will certainly recover from illness. So it's not all disastrous thinking. It's also that one can predict the recovery from ill health on the basis of the movements of the planets. And it's also at this point too, the Taoists and the Buddhists are carrying out rituals in order to enhance those astrological effects. And so some of the rituals directed at Saturn, for example, in the Taoist canon, which I've surveyed in my publication, they're very much interested in longevity. And because longevity and old age was venerated in the Taoist tradition, they seem to have held him as a very sort of favorable deity. Whereas in the original Greek environment, for example, Kronos was an unfavorable, sort of disagreeable god, because old age was something that they wanted to avoid. Eternal youth was more favorable than old age. Now moving on to some of the other doctrines. So Dorotheus, who was a major astrologer in the Hellenistic period, his work was translated into Chinese around the year 800. We don't have the full text anymore, but fragments of it does exist, most notably in the Taoist canon. There's the Ling Tai Jing, and it uses a lot of Dorothean material. So this is really advanced horoscopic techniques. And one of them, for example, is the doctrine of the lots. And it's a very simple doctrine, where basically what you do is you measure the distance between two planets on a birth chart, and then you take that same distance and you measure it from the ascendant at the horizon, the same length going zodiac wise. And so then you end up with a specific part of the chart that has a specific theme to it. And so there's a long list of lots and formulas that you follow in order to look at the lots and the fate of a person. And some of them, for example, which I've highlighted here, deal with longevity, with disaster, with illness, but also the upbringing of your children, your mother, father, and also other things such as love and distress and so forth. Now, what's really interesting in this literature, in the Taoist canon, in the Ling Tai Jing, is that it also describes illnesses, and they're directly associated with the planets. So the sun and the moon are associated with illnesses of the eyes, and Jupiter is associated with wind disorders. Mars is associated with sores and bruising, and Saturn with swelling pains, Mercury illness of chills, Venus illness of coughing, and the lunar nodes, the internal illnesses. Now, if you kind of do a wide survey of astrological literature from the Hellenistic period, particularly, for example, Claudius Ptolemy's work, the Tetrabiblos, what you'll see is that Mars, for example, is associated with skin disorders. So bleeding, rashes, acne, that sort of thing. And so it's interesting that we see this also replicated in the Chinese translations of astrological literature, which shows that there really was this sort of faithful transmission of astrology all the way going back to the Near East through Indo-Iranian intermediaries into China. And so in this case, the planets are associated with specific diseases. And I think on the basis of this, probably astrologers at the time did attempt to diagnose illness and possibly even try to cure them on this basis. So that's something I've argued in some of my studies, that there actually was a tradition of astrological magic. But one of the challenges to my thesis is that nobody ever talks about astrological medicine. And then in the indigenous system of Chinese medicine, there is no discussion of astrological medicine, and they don't incorporate the sort of ideas of the planets and so forth. So that's been a challenge that I've had to accommodate. But so my point would be that this might have been a fringe tradition, and it might not have actually been endorsed by the official traditions of medicine. But nevertheless, we actually do have evidence of the practice of astrological medicine, at least amongst the astrologers at the time. And wrapping up, I'll just point out another interesting fact, is the fact that in some of the astrological texts, the planets are also associated with specific flavors. So the human experience of flavors is also associated with the planets. So Saturn is associated, for example, with salty, bitter, sour flavors, etc. Now, if you compare these to what's given in the Picatrix, which is a 13th century Latin translation of an earlier 10th century Arabic manual of astral magic, you actually find a lot of stark parallels. And so again, what we're seeing here is evidence of a faithful transmission of Near Eastern astrological lore, stemming from, again, this Indo-Iranian tradition into China. And so again, there's this sort of wide variety of astrological lore that's being integrated into conceptions of the body and the human experience in general. And this extended into the centuries after the Tang and the early Song, which is what this talk is largely surveyed. So one of the greatest compendium of astrology in East Asia is the Xing Xue Da Cheng, the Great Compendium of Stellar Studies. And so I have a study which compares this to William Lilly, who was an astrologer in England in the early 17th century. And what we find is that the Chinese had a very long history of astrology going up to this time, just as the Europeans did. And there's actually a lot of parallels, because both of them, ultimately, their traditions of astrology stem from the same source in the Near East. And so astrology was just as popular in 16th century China as it was elsewhere in the world, such as in the Persian and Indian worlds. And so on the basis of that, I will wrap up, and I would be happy to take any questions people might have.
Thank you so much, Dr. Kotyk, for your wonderful, illuminating, and comprehensive presentation on astrology in Tang and Song Dynasty and its connection to its intersection with the conceptualization of the body. So I see that there are already a few questions in the Q&A. I will start, I will soon begin reading some of the questions, but I do want to ask you something before, kind of snatch you for a second, just ask a question and then let the audience pose their question. So I wanted to ask you, based on your presentation, how do Buddhists deal with the contradiction between astrological determinism and karma? You did mention the Shobun Enjokyo, which presents a different vision specifically of karmic retribution, right? So how do these two differences, these two systems, are reconciled and come to bear on questions of health or longevity of the body?
That's a really good question. Thanks for that. So essentially, I would refer to Amoghavadra's text on, and then he does point out that people are born under bad stars. That is to say, they have bad astrology or bad astrological circumstances at birth because of their negative karma. So there is a certain amount of determinism, because you are locked into your birth chart. So the stars under which you're born at birth are immutable. You can't change that, and fate is sort of locked in. But that fate was determined by past life karma. So he kind of straddles determinism and kind of gets over the charges of absolute determinism on the basis of that idea. And you could draw a parallel, for example, with how Buddhists would explain somebody who's born without eyes. So if there's no miracle forthcoming, then this person won't be able to see for the rest of their life. It's sort of it's an immutable aspect of their existence for this lifetime. And so similarly, people born under bad stars are locked into that fate on the basis of their past life karma.
See, thank you so much. That's really fascinating. So I'm going to read some of the Q&A questions here, and do please, I welcome everyone to ask questions, any comments that you wish to express. Dr. Kotyk is, of course, will be happy to address these. So I see that there's a question from Karen Allen, and I'm quoting Karen Allen. So curious, I had expected many relationships to be emerging from the Bagua five elements, I Ching, especially towards ancient and modern TCM, a traditional Chinese medicine. But in the Buddhist tradition, the influence is Vedic and Persian, leading then to a Western astrological conception. There is, by the way, a huge interest currently in Western astrology in China at this time. Where did the five element Chinese astrology emerge from? She's referring to the dragon, rat, monkey, etc.
That's a very good question. So in the period that we're discussing, astrology is, again, largely coming from Iranian and Indian sources. And now there is also the native form of Chinese astrology, but that actually is more celestial omenology. So that's what the court would have recorded about things such as comets and meteorites and also various other inauspicious astral phenomena. But that only was concerned with the welfare of the state and also the ruler, the emperor. So at this point in history, Chinese astrology, or I shouldn't say, well, Buddhist astrology and Taoist astrology, again, is based on the Iranian and the Indian traditions. And then later on, in the 13th and 14th century, you have the introduction of Arabic astrology. But simultaneously, too, in this period also, you see the integration of some astrological concepts into Chinese geomancy. And so that's when we start seeing certain Taoist texts, for example, incorporating sort of these astrological concepts alongside I Ching, as well as the five element theory. And then that matured over time. Now, if you look at Wan Mingying's text from the 16th century, he does discuss Bagua, but he seems to separate that from the practice of horoscopy. So the practice that he understood as horoscopy was practiced alongside other forms of divination, such as Bagua and these other features. But he seemed to have understood horoscopy as a separate tradition. And then there was also further developments also in the Qing dynasty. So in the subsequent centuries after the 17th, 18th, 19th centuries until the modern day. And that's a whole other field, early modern Chinese astrology. There was actually even an introduction of European astrology from the Jesuits in the 17th century, which is a whole other field unto itself. So, but my point would be is that you have the tradition of horoscopy based on the Iranian, Indian, and then later the Arabic sources. And then you also have other forms of Chinese astrology existing simultaneously alongside it. And then we get to the modern period where there's also a lot of developments.
Thank you very much. The next question is from Chris Rapucci. Can you touch some more on what systems or conceptualization of lunar mansions existed in China before the transmissions of the nakshatras?
Right. So there were 28 lunar stations in native Chinese astronomy, and that goes back into deep antiquity. So they divided the movement of the orbital path of the moon into 28 stations, and there's names for each of them, and each of them is also divided into one of four groups. And so that system was used primarily to identify the positions of the planets. And there wasn't as much astrological lore associated with each of them. It was more concerned with positioning the planets relative to the lunar stations. And then later with the introduction of the nakshatras, there came to be more astrological lore associated with the lunar stations in the Chinese tradition.
Thank you. Question from Pamela Winfield. What gender distinctions do these astrological formulae outline? In Japan, there are different bad luck years, yakudoshi, for women versus men, for example. What early indications, if any, are there for women's fate?
Well, the practice of horoscopy in the Chinese context, when you read the literature, it seems to be primarily directed at men, not just common men, but actually it's primarily directed at aristocratic men. And you can tell that, you can gauge that because it talks about royal titles and receiving, presents from royalty and so forth. So this was directed primarily at men, but in some cases too, it does discuss if the client is a woman, then the prediction will be like this. And so those sort of themes primarily concern things such as child rearing, motherhood, and so forth. But that being said, I don't really, in the Tang period materials, I don't really see a strong gendered quality or character to the literature. It tends to be more just about a person's financial, social, and physical health, and it doesn't necessarily specify gender.
Interesting. Okay, question from Lin Tan. Interesting notes on the relation to flavors, but what was the reason as to why they would need that?
That's a good question. Actually, the reason that the flavors are associated with the planets in the text in question is because you're supposed to actually make offerings to the planets of foods associated with those flavors. So, for example, you would offer honey to Venus, and you would offer ginger to Saturn, and then you would offer something that is, for example, salty or bitter to Saturn. And so in this case, it's actually, in this specific context, it's actually involving astral magic.
Hey, question by William McGrath. Thank you for this talk, Jeff. I found the connection between specific planets and illnesses intriguing. In the sources that you have surveyed, were planets ever used to explain epidemics?
Yes, actually in the late 13th century translation of an Arabic manual of astrology, Al-Madkal, it does actually predict epidemics. So what you do is you look at the position of the planets at the vernal equinox at a given geographic location. And then on the basis of the positions of those planets, you can predict various epidemics, and certain planets predict different other kinds of diseases. So for example, the Mars predicts things such as skin disorders and that sort of thing, visible skin disorders. And then the other planets predict other illnesses. So yes, there was a prediction of epidemics, but that seems to come from the translations in the 13th, 14th century, not the Tang Dynasty materials.
Very well. Robert Sedivi, are there any connections between the Chinese astrological charts and the I Ching hexagrams?
Yes. I see that more in the later materials, though, like such as from the late Ming Dynasty onward. I've never seen the I Ching hexagrams as part of the charts in the Tang Dynasty or the Song Dynasty. I should point out that we actually only have a few extant horoscopes, like actual full horoscopes from this period. One of them is actually from Dunhuang. And then we also have two extant horoscopes from Japan, which replicate the Chinese methodology. So we're also kind of dealing with limited materials in some respects, but I don't see the hexagrams really being part of the Chinese astrological tradition until after the Song Dynasty.
All right. And then Parida Stortini is asking, thank you for this fascinating talk. I would love to hear more about the conceptualization of the deities associated with the planets coming from the Middle East in East Asian Buddhism. For example, with what was Saturn associated? Have you any knowledge of how aware East Asian Buddhists might have been of the origin of the deity beyond the India context?
That's a good question. So Saturn was associated with old age, elderly people, beggars, monastics, and he was also associated with bulls and bitter flavors. And the incense that's associated with him is styrax. So it's a kind of pungent, sort of strong aromatic. And you can actually trace these lines back to the Near East. Also, interestingly, too, that those associations with Saturn, you would also see in texts such as the Picatrix, the Gayat al-Hakim, and also Agrippa. So Agrippa was a medieval European occult author who also dealt with astral magic. And he also was drawing upon information and astrological lore from translations of Middle Eastern sources. As to the knowledge of East Asian Buddhists that some of these deities were coming beyond India, there was a sort of nebulous conception of the Western regions, which could include India, Central Asia, Persia, and really everything to the west of China. And the literature seems to suggest that they just associated this sort of thing with the Western regions. One thing I didn't discuss is Teja Prabha Buddha. So he's a very eminent sort of cosmic Buddha that you see, especially in places like Dunhuang and also in the Tangut Kingdom. And you also see examples of Teja Prabha in Korea and Japan. And so in that case, the planets seem to be placated or subservient to Teja Prabha Buddha. So whatever wrathful forces they have sort of exerted on people, it's placated and sort of subverted by Teja Prabha Buddha. So in that case, whether the deities were Buddhist or not is sort of inconsequential, because the whole point is that they have an impact on your fate and well-being, and you want to find a means to placate or to settle them.
Moving on to a question by Oliver Hargrave. Was there any discussion in China of the foreignness of some of these concepts from the Near East? I'm thinking of some of the issues Buddhism had in China with originating in a foreign land.
That's a good question. And I've never actually seen Chinese authors challenge the validity of astrology. So for example, in the Judeo-Christian world, there were actually a lot of challenges to the purported efficacy, the validity of astrology itself, whereas the Chinese authors, I don't really see that. And what you see interestingly in the 9th century too, with the Taoist appropriation of horoscopy, is that they seem to exclude comments that it was foreign in origin. And in some cases too, they attribute it to ancient Chinese astronomers. So it's not really so much a foreign art at that point, but it's been, you know, rapidly sinicized or sinified, and it's become part of the wider religious culture. And because the Chinese religious culture did have a concept of fate, and they also did have a concept of heaven, divinity in the sky above, So that sort of reality didn't really pose any obstacles to the introduction of astrology and horoscopy into Chinese religious culture.
Christina Burman is asking, can you elaborate or speculate on how this may have changed broader conceptions of the body, such as a porous or self-contained physical form? Oh, great question.
That's a great question. Yeah, that's a great question. And my sense would be that rather than limiting the physical form to either the panchaskanda in the Buddhist context or the five elements in the Chinese metaphysical context, at this point, the human body is now associated with the movements of the stars and the planets. So there's sort of a wider integration into a more larger, I guess, metaphysical framework. And it's also that everybody else is simultaneously attached to this sort of new cosmic framework. So it did, I suppose, open up the concept of the human body and make it more porous, especially to the influences of the planets and their transits over the course of time. But that's a very good question. That's something I'll have to think about in the future.
David Wacho, I hope I'm pronouncing the names right. Excuse me if I'm mispronouncing. Can you go deeper into transmission factors into and through the Tarim Basin?
Right. So what we see in places such as Khotan and Kucha and also in Dunhuang is some of the wall murals, for example, have astral deities, and also Teja Prabha Buddha appears as well. I would recommend that you look at Satomi Hiyama's work on Kuchayan cave art, for example, and she looks at some of the astral deities. So we know that in the Tarim Basin that these city-states were interested in astrology, and some of the artwork stemming from this region also displays sort of a deep interest in cosmology. Now, whether there was an impact from those city-states on the astrological practices in China is something that's unclear to me. But primarily just looking at the iconography, we can see that it was transmitted there. And there was also sort of a mixture of Indian and Iranian or Persian elements interspersed in those cultures. So moving on.
A question by E, did native Chinese astrology have any effects on the development of Indian, Persian or Arabic astrology?
That's a good question. I'm not sure I have seen any period sources from Indian, Persian, or Arabic cultures that document Chinese astrology. So I'm not sure if it went the other direction. It'd be interesting if it did. And we know, for example, Marco Polo, when he visited China in the 13th century, reports that astrologers of various countries were actually resident in the capital. So there were Persian and Arabic-speaking astrologers there alongside the Chinese astrologers. So they presumably would have had some knowledge of Chinese astrology, but whether that actually made it back, for example, to the Middle East or India is a whole other question I can't answer.
Question by Dr. DR. In the original conceptualization and division of the sky into the 28 lunar mansions, which were astronomically related rather than astrologically, were they nonetheless associated with deities?
There were, like, for example, the lunar mansions could be grouped together into groups. And for example, the eastern ones were associated with Qinglong, the blue or green dragon. And those deities were worshipped as part of court rituals, primarily seasonal rituals at the Chinese court. There's accounts of these rituals being carried out, and it's recorded in the Tang Dynasty histories, for example. And in those cases, too, there is reference to the lunar mansions being worshipped, but whether they're being worshipped as specific deities or as part of the larger astral pantheon, I'm not sure. And that's something I'll have to look into.
Okay, thank you. Question by Jeannie Liu. Hi, thank you so much for the presentation. Can you elaborate a bit more about the astrology practiced in the Ming Dynasty, both at the court and among commoners?
Right. Well, I don't know if we have enough evidence to discuss how astrology was practiced amongst commoners. And the other concern is that in order to practice natal horoscopy, you have to know the time of a person's birth. And so a person, in order to know their time of birth, has to live in a community that keeps track of time. So in if you lived in, for example, a Ming Dynasty city, they would have announced the hours with the bells, for example. And so somebody in that urban environment probably could have recorded the time of the birth of their children, but somebody living outside an urban area like that might not have been able to record the time of their birth. But amongst aristocrats, we actually do have vast amounts of astrological literature, and a lot of it's preserved in the Suku Chuenshu from the Qing Dynasty. And so Wan Min Ying's work is probably one of the largest. I think it's about 40 juan or fascicles. And that sort of that sort of work really comprehensively digs into a person's birth chart and attempts to look at not just the fate of the person, but also on the effects of the planets on that person over the course of time. And that sort of practice seems to have been so widespread. So for example, Song Lian in the early Ming Dynasty, he was kind of critical of astrology, and he pointed out that Confucius didn't endorse this and that this wasn't practiced in antiquity, because he pointed out in the ancient Chinese classics, there was none of this horoscopy. So it seems that he was a bit aggravated at the time at the popularity of horoscopy amongst his peers, and he discouraged people from practicing it.
So a question from Eric Lee, fascinating talk. I missed the first 10 minutes of your talk, so you might have touched upon this already. What do you see as the reason or reasons for translating and transmitting all these astrological technique and knowledge? How do you explain their popularity during this period of time?
I think the popularity of astrology in the late Tang Dynasty, that is to say the 9th century, might have been in response to various political and social uncertainty. So after the Anlushan Rebellion in the 750s, the authority of the central government in China largely collapsed in a lot of areas, and there was a lot of uncertainty in society. And so this has been proposed in the past by some scholars. I think Zenba Makoto might be one Japanese scholar who discussed this. And he pointed out that because of the social pressures on people and also the great uncertainties, there might have been a trend toward attempting to discern your fate. And there also developed, I think, a market for this as well. So there were professional astrologers who could make a living off of this. And given the sort of general interest in fortune telling and I Ching and so forth, I think this just was another element on the market available to people, which they took an interest in. So so there also would have just, I guess, would have been to some extent a commercial incentive as well. But then it's also when there's a widespread belief in astrology, there's also an interest in mitigating the effects of that astrology or the predicted calamities that might arise down the road. So the Taoists and the Buddhists responded by having various rituals that could eliminate these disasters.
Let me encourage everyone to keep asking questions in the Q&A box. I encourage you also to ask questions about maybe the study of the body in general in relation to astrology. We have a question from an anonymous attendee. Would you please elaborate on the origin of the purple star astrology?
That's a good question. I have a friend from China who practices purple star astrology, Ciwei Dou. And I haven't actually been able to track the origins of it into the Tang or the Song dynasty. And that's something I have to look into greater detail in the future. So I can't actually answer that question at the moment.
We have a question from Pan Pan Gong. The association of incense with planets, were the incense Chinese-based or Indian-based? Mixed incense blend or pure, single ingredient? Did it function like the five elements in Chinese culture, such as the association with human body? So extending to say seasons, food, colors, et cetera.
Right, the incense that are prescribed in the literature are foreign, actually. They would have been imported into China at the time, and they are not mixed. They're just the text says burn this specific incense, burn that specific incense, so they're not mixed. And so that also kind of tells you about the sort of culture, sort of almost, I guess, affluent culture that probably endorsed and practiced these sort of rituals, because these incense would have costed a great deal of money because they would have only been available through import. I don't see them functioning like the five elements, or aside being associated with tastes, they're not necessarily associated with other aspects of the body. And I don't see them associated with seasons or food specifically.
So we have a question from Ronghu Zhu. Chinese standard histories of dynasties usually include a treatise on heavenly bodies, Tianguanshu. I'm wondering if there are traces indicating that Buddhist astrology penetrates into any of these treatises.
Well, not necessarily Buddhist astrology, but foreign astrology. And I think it's in the Yuan dynasty history in the section on astronomy. It actually discusses some of the so-called pseudo-planets that were brought from abroad. So, for example, Rahu and Ketu, for example, are considered pseudo-planets because they're not actual physical bodies and you don't see them. And if I'm not mistaken, it's the Yuan dynasty history that includes some of this. So there actually was also a certain impact of foreign astronomy on Chinese astronomy, particularly starting in the 8th century with the Gautama family translating the Navagraha Karana, which is an Indian astronomical treatise. And so they incorporated some of these ideas into Chinese astronomy over time, particularly starting with the monk Yixing, who died in 727.
Fascinating. If you do have any more questions, please submit them in the Q&A box. In the meantime, I'm going to ask you another question, if you don't mind.
Please.
Dr. Kotyk, you mentioned in these astrological materials the notion of the cosmic man, Purusha.
Yes.
So I'm familiar with the Chinese cosmic man, Pangu.
Mm-hmm.
Or the Japanese version, Banko, which then is also imagined in Omiodo as Gozuteno, the ox king. So I was wondering, is there any Pangu version that is somehow informed by astrology, other than the one that you've showed to us? And maybe I should ask, what is the connection here between astrology and myth?
That's a good question. In this case, the nakshatra purusha is connected not so much with a deity or with a cosmic creator, for example, but rather it's just associated with the individual. So in Amoghavadra's astrology text, it uses this in this one system where it says, if you come to the astrologer and you don't know the moon's position when you were born, if you don't know which one of the lunar stations you fall under, then the body part that you're touching with your right hand when you first go in to talk to the astrologer takes note of that, and then the body part associated, or the lunar station associated with that body part, is the one that you were born under. So in that case, it's kind of integrating the use of the lunar mansions into a person's persona. And the astrologer, on the basis of that, is trying to, I guess, determine the lunar mansion under which they were born. So I don't see really this form of astrology connected with Chinese systems of mythology. I mean, in the Buddhist context, you do have the emergence of the Tejaprabha tradition, in which sort of Tejaprabha presides over the stars and the planets. And that's an interesting example of the belief in astrology kind of deeply affecting the Buddhist worldview and cosmology.
Oh, that's fascinating. I should say that I was asking because of the connection with the body, right? Mm-hmm. Which if you've addressed, but that Purusha or Pangu, has body parts that correspond, right, to the world. So there's this macro, micro, cosmic correspondences.
Right.
Yeah, that's really interesting. So are there any other questions? Pamela Winfield is asking, esoteric Buddhist doctrine and practice attempts to strike macro-microcosmic correspondences across the three secrets. Oh, nice, yeah. Are there any examples of astrologers predicting the fate of the larger body politic in China or Japan? Yeah, wow, great question.
Yeah, that comes from the tradition of field allocation astrology in Chinese, fengye. And David Pankenier has a great, his book on this subject is actually really worth reading. And so effectively what they did was they divided the various spaces of the sky into parallel terrestrial locations on China. So some parts of the sky correspond to some parts of China. And so any sort of astronomical phenomena, particularly inauspicious things such as comets and so forth, would be interpreted and you would interpret that and draw a connection between that part of the sky and also the corresponding part in China. And this was actually practiced at the Chinese court, presumably as early as the Warring States period, even before the Qin unification. And you have it happening all the way until the Qing Dynasty. And this sort of system of field allocation astrology was also, I think, imported to Japan, although I'm not quite clear on how they integrated Japan into this cosmology. But that being said, also the I think it was the supernova that was visible in the 12th century also greatly encouraged a lot of Japanese religious culture and questions about sort of future time and the well-being of the population. And so this sort of thing actually was observed at court, both the Japanese court and the Chinese court.
Another question from an anonymous attendee, any indications of astrology stars influence the tomb burial tradition of astrology or stars that influence tomb burial traditions?
Yeah, there is the famous tomb at Shenhua of the Liao dynasty that actually, when they opened it, they found that you had the various zodiac signs painted on the ceiling. So at that point, we actually do see the zodiac signs being implemented into this tomb burial culture. And that's the most famous example I can think of.
So does anyone have further questions to ask Dr. Jeffrey Kotyk? We'll give the audience maybe a few seconds. Okay, there doesn't seem to be any more question in sight. Thank you all for joining us this evening. And of course, a very special thanks to our guest speaker tonight, Dr. Jeffrey Kotyk, for a wonderful presentation. We hope that you all enjoyed tonight's program. Please do not forget to join us on Monday, May 10th at 5 p.m. Chicago time, as we welcome UC Davis Professor Howard Chiang for the next installment of the series, where he will talk about castration fever on trans body and psychoanalysis in modern China. The direct link to register for the event will be placed in the chat box. As a reminder, if you're interested in learning more about the upcoming events hosted by the Center for East Asian Studies here at the University of Chicago, please click on the links being provided again in the chat box. We also encourage you to subscribe to CEAS emails so that you can receive up-to-date information on future virtual events related to East Asia. Again, thank you all for attending tonight's program, and please have a wonderful rest of the evening.